Greetings all, I'm Aaron Mills, and welcome to the Riverdale Vlogs. This will be a vlog series where I watch each episode of Riverdale and, you know, give my thoughts on it before the next one airs, and we'll see where it goes from there. Now, if you're not certain, Riverdale is a brand new show that has just started recently on the CW. It is also based on the classic characters of Archie comics. Now, for those of you wondering, it's like, well, wait a minute, how the hell does that work? It's Archie Comics. It's Archie Andrews and Betty and Veronica and all them. Yeah, and basically it's that, but pushed into something we really haven't seen before with the Archie Comics characters, unless, of course, you've been reading Archie Comics for the last few years. I'll get into that in a minute. So here's how it works. Basically, the way the thing is set up is that it's the town of Riverdale, and everybody's come back from their summer vacation, and over the course of the summer, a lot of things happened. A lot of things happened with the characters and all that and everything else. Most notably, what happened is Jason Blossom, the twin brother of Cheryl Blossom, who basically has been for the last, I think she started in the late 80s when she became a real force in there. Since the late 80s has been the Archie Comics mean girl, basically. Sort of Veronica's nemesis, and, you know, she's always causing trouble and just being Cheryl. They went out on a boat on the morning of the 4th of July. Cheryl and Jason went out on the boat on the 4th of July, and at some point during the thing, during the day, during that morning, Jason fell into the river and supposedly drowned, but his body was never found. And it wasn't until later that Dilton Doily, Riverdale's resident genius, encountered Cheryl soaking wet on the side of the bank of the river. Okay, so that's the basic premise, but of course it's more than that, because basically, yeah, it's going in there. Roberto Aguirre-Sacasa, who is the showrunner, and is also Archie Comics' chief creative officer, and most notably is the mastermind behind the Archie horror line of series, Afterlife with Archie and Chilling Adventures of Sabrina, has said that they're basically treating this as Archie meets Twin Peaks. And so far, it's a little up in the air on that. It hasn't really reached the level of weird that Twin Peaks has, but it's only been one episode so far. So basically, so far the only parallels we have to Twin Peaks is a teenager getting killed at the beginning and things kind of being a little dark and edgy, you know? Now, I want to dispel a couple of things that people have said, because a lot of things I've heard people criticizing about Riverdale are from people who know absolutely, are quite clearly people who haven't read an Archie comic in years. They don't understand what's going on, and they probably didn't even actually watch the show. They just based it off the trailers that the CW had been putting out, which, to be honest, the trailers are fucking horrible. They are. They're terrible. They don't even begin to come close as to what's going on. If you're expecting this to be your stereotypical goofy Archie, it's like, how the hell does that work? Archie looks goofy and all that. If you're expecting it to look more like some of these, something like this, if you're expecting the artwork to be more like this in the classic Archie style, if you're expecting this kind of Archie, you're not going to get it. That's not quite right for what we're doing here. If anything, the series takes more of its cue from the recently rebooted version of Archie, which is still a comedy. Don't get me wrong. In the comics right now, this is the current Archie series, it's still a comedy, and it's still Archie being clumsy and goofy and all that, but there's a little more serious to it, a little more drama, and a little more like that. Anyway, just that's kind of where it's working. If you're expecting the traditional Archie stuff that's been going on from 1941 until about a year and a half ago, you're not going to get it. The original Archie line, the classic Archie line, this one right here, the one that you're thinking of, this version of Archie, this edition of Archie, this universe of Archie, came to an end with, ironically enough, Archie number 666. So that ended, and that started Archie Volume 2, which is this one. And unlike the DC Comics reboot, they committed to rebooting everything. DC ended all their regular titles. They ended Archie, they ended Jughead, they ended Bendy Veronica, and they just started over with everything. So, things are different in Archie Comics, and that's a good thing, because honestly, right now, Archie Comics is writing some of the most compelling comics writing that there is. So, if you're expecting Riverdale to reflect the old first volume Archie type stuff, that's not going to happen. It's more in line with the modern stuff, which is not a bad thing. A lot of the complaints lodged against Riverdale, at least when the trailers came out, it was like, God, does everything have to be dark and gritty? And that's a legitimate gripe, and certainly the trailers made it look that way, but here's the thing, Riverdale is really not all that dark and gritty. It isn't. This is not the dark, gritty reboot of Archie. I'll talk about some of the things that everybody knows about here in a minute, but is it darker? Yeah, but not by much. It's basically take Archie and change it from a comedy to a drama. That's all it really is. That's all that's really happened, is just the shift in tone from comedy to drama. That's really the main difference. And for those who want to complain that Archie's never been like that, Archie's always been fun and bright and happy, again, you haven't read an Archie comic in the last few years. With the death of, I want to say, Richard Goldwater? His son John has taken over Archie Comics, and John has a little bit more flexible idea of the kind of stories you can tell with Archie and company. Before that, when his father was in charge, he was very, very strict about this is how we do the things, this is the style we do the art story in, this is what we do, these are what we do, this is how we do it, and we don't like other alternative things. Get on fanfiction.net, tell them we don't permit fan works, we don't permit fanfiction of our characters on their site. No. I don't know if that's still in effect, but yeah, for the longest time, yeah, you can't post. As far as I know for right now, you cannot actually post Archie Comics fanfiction on fanfiction.net. We'll see how that happens with Riverdale. But if you think that Archie has never been gritty or has never tackled darker things, I would suggest you look at some of the stories that came out in the 50s and 60s, because there were usually stories where Archie and his friends would jump onto the Lodge family jet and go to some exotic locale and get involved in some sort of bizarre adventure in some foreign land. I read a story years ago where Archie, you know, basically wound up being chased up the Eiffel Tower by, you know, smugglers who were shooting at him with guns and stuff. Okay? You know, and Archie's always been willing to take chances with that kind of thing. I mean, right over here, yes, I have a copy of Archie Meets the Punisher, a story that by all rights should not have worked, and yet it does, and doesn't cheapen either character. All right, even more so, yeah, and let me clarify this, because this has been a little pet peeve of mine for a while. Yes, they killed Archie in this series alone. This was the series called Life with Archie. It was a magazine which was split into two different storylines, Archie Marries Betty and Archie Marries Veronica. So it's two different storylines, and basically they all both ended in the exact same way. The last two issues of The Married Life, as it became known, did not make it clear which universe we were in, implying that it happened in both. And yeah, if you think Archie can't get dark, yeah, check that shit out, gang. Archie got shot, and Archie fucking died. Died a hero, but he died, but only in that particular story and that particular universe. As a matter of fact, this series firmly established that, yes, Veronica, there is an Archie multiverse, but that's another topic for another time. So, if you haven't read those stories, or even any of the horror, Archie horror, like Afterlife with Archie or Chilling Adventures of Sabrina, and that's what you're expecting from Riverdale, and you're saying, it's never been like that. Yes, it has. Several times. I mean, and since John took over, they're taking even more chances. Archie versus Predator. Just about everybody goddamn dies in Archie versus Predator. There is, in fact, Archie versus Sharknado, where, again, just about everybody goddamn dies. It's ridiculous, and Sabrina keeps getting the shaft in these stories. Afterlife, Archie versus Predator, and Archie versus Sharknado, she just gets the shaft. Poor Sabrina. Who may or may not, according to rumors, be making an appearance in Riverdale somewhere down the line. So that'll be interesting. So let's talk about Riverdale itself. The main thing for me in any adaptation of Archie from a comics to a live or animated medium is how well do these characters translate? Are they still recognizably the characters we know and love? And I'm happy to report that the answer is yes, believe it or not. Despite the fact that this is a darker series and the focus is more on drama rather than comedy, these are still recognizably the Archie characters. Okay? Archie is still the all-American boy next door. He's kind of conflicted and clumsy and well, not clumsy, we haven't really seen that, but he's kind of conflicted, he's not sure of himself, he looks confident, but he's not. He usually has harebrained schemes, and yes, even the schemes that he has in this are pretty harebrained, although not in a comedic way, I'll get into that in a minute. Veronica, while still being, you know, the poor little rich girl, is still very much the same kind of Veronica, you know, who basically has, for years, a lot of people want to paint Veronica as the bitch. But she's not a bitch. Veronica's never been a bitch. Veronica is the embodiment of the phrase, do no harm, but take no shit. And this is true here. Veronica is still recognized as Veronica. Betty is still, you know, Miss Perfect, you know, the girl next door. The girl next door, the one who's in there. I haven't seen, there's some other elements of Betty's character which I haven't seen in Riverdale yet, but I'm sure they will eventually. You know, Reggie is still an egotistical, arrogant dickwad, and that's fine. Jughead is kind of up in the air at the moment, because Jughead is in Riverdale, the first episode of Riverdale, for all of about 3 minutes. So, not the jury's still out on Jughead, on how well Cole Sprouse is portraying Jughead. It depends on what more they do with him. Right now he's only had one scene with Archie, and that really wasn't very long. So it's not quite enough to get a handle on where they're going with Jughead with this. And here's the thing. A lot of people want to yell at this thing for, like, it's just another dumb teen CW show with the Archie character's name slapped on it. That's kind of a valid criticism. But here's the thing. The crew on the show are very, very aware of the kind of show that CW is known for and the kind of show that they want them to be, that they want this to be there. And everybody brings this up. You know, okay, so let's bring up the basic ideas. Here's the things that happen, which are typical CW-isms that happened in Riverdale. One, we see Archie without a shirt, and yes, he's got a six-pack, and he's ripped, and all that jazz. Yes. Two, Kevin Keller, the first openly gay character ever in comics, by the way, at least as far as I know, at least who got his own series. I could be wrong on that. Don't quote me. I could be wrong. I'm not sure. Anyway, but yeah, Kevin is more or less every flamboyant gay stereotype you ever saw, except for being, like, way over the top, but, like, the high school gay kid, he's in there with all that. I mean, yes, we have the love triangle between Betty, Veronica, and Archie. We have to. It's Riverdale. That's just the way it is. Yeah, we have the murder of Jason Blossom. Yes, Cheryl is the queen bee bitch of the school, who's, like, causing problems just because she can. Yes, all right, we'll talk about the big thing as well. And yes, there is a plot element, which we'll talk about in a minute, that really smacks of CW-isms. But here's the thing. Actually, let me get that plot element out of the way, because everybody knows about it anyway. Yes, during the course of the summer, we discover that Archie and Miss Grundy, who has been aged down to, like, late 20s or early 30s, over the summer had a tryst of some sort. It appears to have only happened once in the evening of July 3rd and into the morning of July 4th. And yes, that happened, and everybody's going, oh God, what the hell, our Archie's having sex with his teacher. What the? And even the people who are okay with this as a plot element, or I've seen people saying, well, that's just going to screw up the whole Betty, Veronica, Archie thing. It's like, no, it hasn't. And I'll get into why in a minute. Because, as I said, the showrunner and the team that are behind this show are well aware that this was one of the criticisms they were going to run into. How do I know this? Because they do everything they can to subvert those CW-isms as soon as they start. Let's take it one at a time. Archie gets ripped, and we find out from dialogue that he wasn't like that over the summer. Why? Because he went to work with his dad at his father's construction company. Fred Andrews apparently runs a construction company, is a contractor in this universe. So, no idea what he actually did. I thought it was just an office job in the comics, but whatever. Excuse the phone went off. Anyway. So Archie's ripped, yes, and we see this through his bedroom window from Betty's house across the street from her bedroom, but it's not Betty who notices. This CWism gets subverted by the fact that it's Kevin who notices. With the greatest line, with one of the best lines in the episode, oh my god, Archie got hot. Look at that, that's six more reasons for you to go after him. You know, I mean, there's another CWism in the scene where Betty's in her bra and she doesn't care because Kevin's gay, so who cares? But, you know, whatever. Frankly, who cares? It's one scene. I'm not going to get bent out of shape over that. There's your subversion number one. Number two comes later at lunch when Cheryl... Now, better clarify here. For this particular series... Veronica and her mother have moved to Riverdale. In this case, her mother's from here. Hiram Lodge, Veronica's dad, is in jail. Apparently, he's like this Bernie Madoff kind of character, and I'm sure that will come into play later on down the line. In the meantime, Veronica's trying to remake her image because she realized that all these people who started saying horrible things about her were on the internet after her father was arrested were basically true, that she was the spoiled little rich bitch. So she's trying to redeem herself and start over in Riverdale by actually being nice and becomes friends with Betty. So before we get into that, I'll backtrack. So Cheryl shows up and, you know, wants to kiss up Veronica because Veronica's power and all that, blah, 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 whatever. And what's funny is she invites Veronica to try out for the cheerleading team. Now, in case you haven't noticed, cheerleading hasn't really been a thing in a lot of teen-oriented programming for, like, a while. Like, the whole popular cheerleader trope has kind of just gone away. But, you know, it's still being used here. And what's funny is that it goes once again with more fun stuff from Kevin. Cheryl invites Veronica to join the team, and Kevin just says, is cheerleading still a thing? To which Cheryl responds, I don't know, is being the gay best friend still a thing? Which is exactly what Kevin is. He is the gay best friend, you see, in all this, to both Betty and Veronica. So, yeah, it's that kind of subversion. Later, when Betty and Veronica are trying out for cheerleading, you know, Cheryl's not impressed. So Veronica just up and kisses Betty, and everybody's like, ooh, and it's like, but again, this gets subverted. Because the very first thing out of Cheryl's mouth is, check your sell-by date, ladies. Faux lesbianism hasn't been taboo since 1994. So yeah, Betty and Veronica kissed, and it's clear. I mean, she just basically warns her, says, I'm gonna do something, just go with it, don't freak out. You know, this hasn't stopped the shippers on Tumblr from going crazy, you know. Shipping is a plague. I could care less about the romantic stuff going on here, and I'm more interested in the character interactions beyond who's fucking who, okay? I really don't care. So, take your little pet names for whatever your couples are and go have fun. Just leave me out of it. I don't care. So, yeah, and yeah, we have the Betty, Archie, Veronica love triangle. After the dance, it's in the story. In the episode, they go to Cheryl's party. Cheryl locks Archie and Veronica in the closet for a game of 7 minutes in heaven. They have a conversation and they kiss, but they both feel bad about it when they realize that, you know, this they shouldn't have kissed, and Betty's hurt, and Betty runs off, and they go looking for Betty and all that. again, actual maturity from these characters realizing that, oh shit, we fucked up. In fact, oh shit, we fucked up is kind of Archie's main motivation here. Because getting back to the tryst with Ms. Grundy, and I want to say this again, this is another thing. If I see another person call her Mrs. Grundy, I'm gonna smack you. She is not married. The character has only been married in the married life thing to Mr. Weatherby for a very brief time. So, no. Ms. Grundy, not Mrs. Ms. Okay? Okay, good. Anyway, so the tryst with Ms. Grundy ends up with both of them realizing, oh shit, we fucked up, this shouldn't have happened, that was a bad thing. And in a situation like that, both of them could probably keep their mouths shut, never happen again. Both of them agree it was a mistake. Both of them, mind you. Archie's not trying to get with Miss Grundy. Miss Grundy's actually just trying to not be left alone with Archie just in case something does happen. Because obviously she's worried about, you know, her career, her reputation, the fact that quite possibly she'd be facing statutory rape charges because, again, Archie and company are meant to be sophomores in this thing. And don't start with me. With the, sure, they're sophomores, 30-year-old sophomores, Okay, morons, if you're one of the morons who's been making that joke, you're not clever, you're not funny, and you're not pointing out anything nobody already doesn't already know, okay? 20-somethings playing much younger teenagers is nothing new. It's been going on for decades. Look at any slasher movie from the early 80s or earlier. It's been going on at least that long, probably longer, quite honestly. So you're not being clever when you're like making comments about 30-year-old sophomores in high school. Nobody cares. It's not funny. You're not witty. Nobody cares. Okay, yeah. So basically, yeah. Miss Grundy doesn't want to because she's worried about the possible social, employment, and legal repercussions. And Archie really doesn't want to say anything either because he feels just as bad about it. But the problem is, and this is where the drama comes in, it's not the fact that Archie and Miss Grundy did what they did. It's not that at all. What it is the fact that after they were done the following morning, they heard a gunshot out by the river. They have important evidence as to Jason Blossom's murder. Archie, despite the fact that he fucked up, honestly is still a good guy through all this. He doesn't want to hurt anyone's feelings. He wants to legitimately do the right thing. The problem is that right now, he's not sure what the right thing is. Okay? He tries out for football because he thinks it'll make people happy, and his dad wants him to go work for the company, and he uses that as an excuse as to why he can't really jump on the varsity team because there's an opening, because plot convenience, and all that. And really, throughout this whole thing, anytime these kind of things that you would normally roll your eyes at in any teen drama convince that you're gonna have to deal with it for God knows how long before they finally decide to resolve it. No, they fucking resolve that shit in the same episode. Case in point, Archie tries out for football because but what he really wants to do is make music because he's been writing music lyrics as a way to cope with what happened over the summer. But that's what he wants to do. And Ms. Grundy he tries to get help from Josie and the Pussycats, who are all black in this series, and that's fine. A lot of people's races have been changed, and that's fine. Josie and the Pussycats, they're all black now. I can get behind it. Not a lot with Josie, and really hardly anything with Val and Melody. So, again, much like Jughead, not sure where they're going to go with them. We need to see more of them before I can make a call on that. Anyway, he goes to Josie, and Josie wrongly, a lot of people like put it as Josie putting Archie in his place for checking Archie's privilege for him, because she just kind of shuts him down. But all he actually says is, I just was wondering if I could get your help with some music I wrote. And Josie wrongly assumes, or at least this is how I'm interpreting it. I could be wrong. We'll see what happens as we go on. Josie wrongly assumes this means that he's trying to foist his music off on them when they prefer to do their own stuff, as well they might. And she just kind of shuts him down, kind of bitchy, but the thing is, it's just like, all he's trying to do is get some help in whether or not his stuff is good, whether he should continue it, and he went to Josie because she's got a band, which she would, and she doesn't want to go to Miss Grundy, who is the music teacher in this universe, because obvious reasons. Well, anyway, eventually, basically it works out that in exchange for not saying anything about anything that happened over the summer, Miss Grundy agrees to do an independent study with Archie before school, Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. So, and then Archie gets on the football team and he tells the coach he has to go to work, he might have to go to work for his dad and he can't do that. And his dad calls him on that shit. He says, "Who are you lying to?" And Archie has to admit he's lying to both, because basically he told his dad that he couldn't work for him because he was going to be doing football, and he told the coach that he can't do football because he's working for his dad. And, you know, Archie's dad is justifiably hurt. It's that kind of thing when you're growing up and you're trying to figure out who the hell you are and your parents aren't sure who you are and you're not sure who you are and all that. And, you know, Archie's dad just tells him, "Listen, it doesn't matter to me if you play football or not. It doesn't matter to me, and you don't have to work for me if you don't want to. Work with me if you don't want to. Just make sure you know what you want and make sure the decisions that you're making are the ones that are right. Because that stuff sticks with you." And it does. Okay, this is Archie growing up, and it's hard for him. You know, especially with this other thing, with the gunshot hanging over his head. So, we're probably going to see more of that. Another thing that falls into the CW-isms. In this particular story, Jason Blossom apparently dated Betty's older sister, Polly, and then dumped her, and Polly got a little crazy, and Polly just kind of got a little crazy afterwards, and because she was the wild daughter, and Betty's mom, who is, quite frankly, a real fucking bitch in this series, she's the one that's just like, she's like the overprotective mom, like to the ridiculous point, like she's got Betty on Adderall, and she really doesn't need to be, and all that, and everything, and, you know, and it's just like, you think, oh God, we're gonna have Betty being a waffling back and forth on her mom. No, Betty stands up for herself, tells her mom to go screw herself when she says she can't be on the cheerleading squad because Cheryl's the captain, and she can't date Archie because Archie's got red hair and Jason Blossom had red hair. So it's just like, it's one of those things where Betty just tells her mom off. I'm sure there'll be fallout, but the fallout is more interesting than sitting through episode after episode of the tension. It's like, it finds the seat of the show, finds the things that every teen drama does, and then gets them out the fuck out of the way so you can do the more interesting stuff, like the fallout, like everything else. You know, the love triangle between Betty and Veronica and Archie has been around since 1941, you know, and it's always been unique in the history of love triangles in that Betty and Veronica don't hate each other. They're not really fighting over Archie. You know, it's not, nobody's serious about any of it. They're still, Betty and Veronica are best friends, and that's still true here. Or maybe, we'll see. You know, Archie goes and, you know, after talking to Jughead, and I'll get into that in just a second, our Jughead basically tells him, just go tell Betty how he feels, and Betty asks him, "Do you love me?" He's like, "Yes, I love you, but I can't give you the answer you want right now." And he tells her why. It's not because he doesn't love her, it's because he's got this hanging over his head. He doesn't tell her about the gunshot or Ms. Grundy, but he basically tells her that she's too good for him. And right now, with the shit he's done so far, yeah, she kind of is. Betty's too good for Archie at this point. So, yeah, and at the end of the episode, Jason Blossom's body is found. There's a big friggin' gunshot wound right here. And, yeah. The other thing, like I said, Jughead is not in this first episode all that much. He's the narrator. He's apparently writing a novel based on everything that's going on. which is kind of meta, and I have to wonder if maybe this will be some of the Twin Peaks come in, like, we'll get through everything and discover at the end of the, if the series gets, you know, no matter how long the series runs, if at the end it turns out that this whole thing was just Jughead putting a noir filter over the town, and it's, he's been writing a heavily fictionalized version of everything that's been going on. That would be kind of cool. Kind of silly and really like, what? What? Really kind of sane elsewhere, but kind of cool too. If that's the direction they went with it, I don't think they will. I'm sure plenty of other people have thrown that idea out already. But in the one scene that Archie does have with Jughead, and you notice this throughout the whole thing, that Archie is really not interacting with Jughead, despite Archie and Jughead being best friends, to as far as everyone knows. But Archie goes and he runs into Jughead at Pops while he's looking for Betty after the party, and, you know, things are kind of tense. You get the feeling that something's going on between Archie and Jughead. You're not sure what. And then Jughead says, listen, if you want to, if you really are concerned about Betty and you want to make sure she's okay, just go talk to her. It'll go a long way. It would have with me. Which means that there's something going on. Archie and Jughead had some sort of falling out. So they're not necessarily friends right now. They're friends, but they're that kind of weird thing when you have an argument with your best friend, like a really bad argument or something happens, and it's just kind of weird when the two of you are in the same room together and you just kind of have to be away from each other for a while to get it all, so you're both in a position where you can deal with it. So, yeah. As far as other characters in the series, so far, Reggie, again, another character not in there, but he's gone full dude bro. He's Asian in this one, and that's kind of cool. And he, but he is, you know, total dude bro. He's like, seriously, he's even more tasteless, if anything. Archie comes back. They come back from summer vacation. Word's gotten around that Archie's gotten ripped over the summer. And he's just like, so you've been doing some houses? Yeah. Yeah. So he's seen it later. Did you tap some fine cougar ass during the course of it? And it's just like, what's funny is that it turns out to be completely true, because this is before the reveal that Archie slept with Miss Grundy. It's like, because he does this and he walks off and Reggie's just like, he totally did. You know, Reggie and Moose are friends, which is a little unusual. I haven't seen Midge yet, Moose's girlfriend, which is kind of interesting because they decided to make Moose at the very least bi-curious in this thing, because he actually propositions Kevin, and it's Kevin and Moose who find Jason's body later that night. So, yeah, a lot of it, like a lot of first episode, not a lot of resolution to everything, but the good news is that it seems that the crew knows where the pitfalls are with this kind of show and are doing their best to avoid them while still keeping these people, these characters, the traditional Archie characters that we know and love. And so far, they're doing just fine. Most of the cast is actually really good. KJ Apa is a fairly credible Archie. Archie's a little underdeveloped, but then Archie's always been kind of underdeveloped. Camila Mendez is, I believe that's her name, Camila Mendez is very good as Veronica. She's easily one of the standouts. Lily Reinhardt, I'm not sure about yet. She plays Betty. Betty has always been the sweet, nice girl next door, but underneath it all, Betty's got a lot of fire to her, and when she can't take any more, she has no qualms about just unleashing on somebody, and that hasn't happened yet. Closest we get is when Cheryl's trying to get Betty to bitch her out about Polly during the cheerleading tryouts. We see that Betty clenches her fist so hard that her nails dig into the palms of her skin, drawing blood. I don't know where they're going to go with that. She's okay as Betty, but that, I'm not sure if it's her performance or if it's the way she's been written so far. So the clear thing to keep in mind is that Roberto Aguirre Sarcasa, and I swear, every time I try to say his last name, I'm horribly mangle it, and I apologize, has said in interviews that they're treating the first season of Riverdale like an origin story. So these aren't quite the Archie characters that we know and love, but they're going to get there eventually. We'll see what happens. I hope they bring in there. They've thrown in a bunch of other little tidbits here and there for really diehard Archie fans. When Archie goes to the dance with Betty and Veronica. Well, that's the other thing. He does go to the dance with both Betty and Veronica, but it's Betty's idea for all three of them to go together. So That's just kind of how it works. Anyway, when they go, Archie's got a bow tie, is wearing a bow tie, which is remarkably similar to his original design back in 1941 that was drawn all the time. That's the traditional one you see with the orange pants with the black grid and the sweater vest with the R on it and the bow tie and all that. So that was kind of cool. And in the ads and whatnot, you'll see, yes, Jughead has his traditional crown type thing, only in this case, rather than being what was traditionally the way these things were designed, which is called a whoopee hat, which was usually a fedora that was all cut up and reformed and the brim taken off and all that. That was usually how those were made. In this case, it's like a standard beanie type cap, but the brim has been like cut around to form the crown shape, and it's got the usual buttons and badges and whatnot on there. So that was kind of cool. And yeah, Jughead's infamous S that nobody understands what it is. All right, if you're not familiar with Archie Comics, let me explain. Ever since the beginning, Jughead has often been depicted wearing a shirt with an S on it. The only person who knew what that S was about was the Archie artist who did it to begin with. And he died, apparently, without telling anyone why. He would always hint that there was a reason, but you never actually found out why Jughead kept wearing this shirt with the S on it. And they've kept up that tradition here, too. The new Archie series offers an explanation, and it's a pretty good one. But as far as whether or not it's in there, you'll see Cole Sprouse's Jughead wearing the S shirt. On his laptop computer that he always has is the same S on there where you would normally see like the manufacturer's logo and all that. So they put all that in there, and it's really cool, and it's really good. So yeah, Riverdale is actually pretty good. I mean, yeah, it's not great television. It's not going to win any Emmys or, you know, do anything groundbreaking. But as far as a new take on the Archie universe, this is actually pretty good. And I recommend it. And I'm going to keep watching and we'll get into what happens. Like I said, not a lot. It's mostly set up. This first episode, mostly set up, but some really good performances, some intriguing writing, and I'm looking forward to seeing where it goes. So, look for the next one in a couple of days. Oh, just so everybody understands, I will not be releasing a vlog right after the episode airs. I don't currently have TV, so I have to watch it all through my phone on the CW's app. I have to watch it through my phone because there's no CW app for the PS3. Go figure. Anyway, but I gotta watch it on here, and CW does not put up new episodes until the day after they air. So, whereas the rest of the world gets Riverdale on Thursday, I don't get it till Friday. So I will try to get these vlogs up in a timely fashion. I hope, hopefully, you know, since I only need to ramble for a while and maybe do a couple of quick edits for stammers and whatnot, I can get them up fairly quickly on top of everything else. Maybe Saturdays on Saturday and Riverdale vlogs on Sunday. Who knows? But in the meantime, thank you for joining me for this first edition of the Riverdale Vlogs. And we'll see what happens to Archie and Company next. Later.